seat, and after a week or two, someone is saving you a seat, and saying, here, I, you know, sit here, and then, I had a girlfriend last couple of years, so she always had the seat in front of me, and she saved the seat behind me. Anyway, okay, let's open this morning, then we'll have some more announcements. To God be the glory. Let's stand, shall we? Teach us, help us to be able to apply things to our own lives for us to use as we leave here this morning. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
All right. Few announcements. Anyway, if you didn't get a bulletin, they're on the back there. There is an insert. Make sure you take a take the time to read that and then pass it on to the doctor's office or something like that. Or give it to your doctor or whatever. Neat little things that are in that. Thanksgiving baskets. If you know someone in the area that could use a Thanksgiving basket from our church, that Tony and his crew, I'm not sure who goes with it, but they put together a real neat Thanksgiving gift basket for those in the community. So someone that you just think needs to have a contact from Albion Bible Church, let Tony know about that. Right after the morning service, missions committee, we're going to be meeting over in the conference room there. Make sure you get over there. We'll have our monthly meeting back there. Ladies' tea, 11:11. back there, for you to sign in for the last few days, man, November is, what, Tuesday, Wednesday, whatever it is, it's really coming up fast. And we have someone this morning that has been rehearsing what she's gonna say this morning. And she said as soon as she stands up, she's gonna forget it all. Anyway, Kathleen, why don't you tell us what you love about our pastor?
I'm Kathleen. Okay, let's see, I like his jokes, even the ones that go over like a lead balloon. I like his stories, even the ones that make me cry. I love all the outside the Bible information that he gives when he's telling something, a story. And it like clicks it, oh, is that what, now I understand, okay? And he has paid me one of the nicest compliments anyone has ever paid me, that I'm an active listener.
Very good.
And I really never have teacher tell me that. But the fact that he thinks I'm active listening, it makes me feel good because I do listen and pay attention. And I'm very thankful for you. So thank you.
Thank you. Some of you who are very active listeners, and I hang on to that because, I need it. But, thank you so much. I think it's October 29th. Anyone know what happened 15 years ago today? No?
Sure.
Phillies won the World Series.
Thought I'd
just bring that up. Good morning!
Good morning.
It's great to see so many of you here this morning. I had so many thoughts going through my head as David was going through the announcements. And it's 57th, you said?
I think it's 56.
I was going to say, because I was at your 50th.
I was so young.
Yeah. Right? I was so young. She's like, if I had to do it over again. But no, that praise God, that is just awesome. I know for a fact that David and Nancy have been marriage role models to so many people. I know me and Crystal often we use you guys as examples. Well, Dave and Nancy would do that, so it's literally inspiring and encouraging. So 56, 57, that you guys can't remember is to be encouraging as well, because when are we like, 2, 3, I don't even know anymore. But I don't have to know because Dave and Nancy don't know. But praise God, that's awesome. There's so many things that we need to be praying for one another about. I'm going to start with Shirley, because Shirley's it's breaking my heart back there, Shirley, the way you're so still. And you can see it in your eyes that Shirley's in pain right now. She's in a lot of pain. Anyone who's seen Shirley in the last 6, 8 months knows she's been in pain. She constantly. And so you said, when do you have the appointment?
November the 6th.
November the 6th, she's going to get some needles put into her spine and her neck and things and whatnot. So just pray for that. Pray that it gives her some relief and reprieve from the pain. Pray that it's not just for temporary, but the doctors can figure things out to get the pain out of the way. And pray that this pain doesn't become frustrating and cause emotional pains and emotional challenges and discouragement. And pray that she can still even take care of Jack. Jack, how you been?
It's good to see you.
All right. So continue to pray for the Welker household as we approach November 6th. There's a number of surgeries and things that are needed. Dave, when's your surgery?
Monday a week,
so that's the 6th.
Six.
So 6th. Everything happened. Any other surgeries on the 6th? No. I know we were praying for Jake, and he had his surgery rescheduled. So, not my son, but Jacob, Lane's friend. So pray for him, because he's in pain right now. He needs back surgery. And Hunter is going in for surgery at one point, right? The 9th? Okay, and we heard that Cooper, Marge's grandson, praise God that he was supposed to have surgery, but his heart found the rhythm, or found, what was it exactly, the murmur?
The pediatrician found a heart problem, but the cardiologist said it's so minimal, he doesn't even need to see
him. Praise God, that's awesome. Praise God. That's the best way to pray for surgery, is that it doesn't need to take place, that God works a miracle before it. So, awesome. And there's so many other things that we need to pray for. What else do we need to pray for? I know
think that went on for far too long for there not to be something in there to follow.
Keep Jen in your prayers. She's not doing well. The UTI is just the beginning of the physical. She has all kinds of depressions and just, it's causing all kinds, and it's, the emotional is causing all kinds of physical problems. So she's not doing well. And like Kathleen said, it's been months now. It's been months, whether it's been different aspects, different feet, different body parts, but she's been depressed and discouraged and hurting over it. And she retired recently, so it could be the idea that she feels that she doesn't have a purpose or a need anymore, or it could be so many things. So like I said last week, reach out to her. Text her, call her, visit her, whatever God needs you to do. Whatever God needs you to do. She doesn't want text messages. Some of you have texted, she hasn't responded. Who cares? Text her again.
She
you
just know? Is so weak. She can't hold the
phone. I understand. That's what she said to me. That's what she said to me when she responded to my text. Because I know she didn't respond to a lot of you. But don't let it discourage you. She's in pain, and so whether God needs you to reach out to her in whatever way, make sure that you follow God's lead, follow God's call, because Jen needs it. Jen needs it right now. Anything else we need to pray for? Yeah, Jen.
Just another great report for my friend Donna, who had her surgery on Tuesday.
Awesome.
She's been walking around. She is in pain and it's still recovering, so just continue prayer. And then the praise report for my mom's heart. Rhythm was back to normal by the time I made it home on Sunday. So.
That is absolutely incredible. You mentioned that Sunday, so good. Yeah, we were praying for her, and then probably around time we were praying for her. Yeah, her heart is finally written. So praise God. Often we'll bring up something like a year and a half ago, we started praying for Ukraine, and then it just slowly faded away. And I know some of you still do, but as a body here, and now 2 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago, we start praying for Israel. I don't want these things to, look, if we don't mention them every week, I don't want you guys to not continue to pray for them. Because we need to continue to pray for the peace of Jerusalem. There's still all kinds of craziness going on in that area, and there's all kinds of, I'm not going to go into the details of it, but I'm going to continue to stress that we don't forget God's people, and that we don't let, God has not forgotten his people. Romans 11 tells us he has not rejected and left his people, so we shouldn't. So let's make sure we continue to pray for the peace and the protection of God's people in his own land. So anything else we need to be praying for? I know after I always bring up Israel, no one has anything after that. Like you guys feel your heart is important. But please, it's just, we need to make sure we're praying for one another. And I say this often, but make sure that you choose. If you're not going to pray for everything on here, grab a bulletin before you leave and pray for one thing on here. And then let that person know you're praying for them. And just let God use your prayers to encourage. God use your prayers to strengthen. And let God use your prayers to conform us and to his will. So right now, if there's nothing else we need to pray for, let's all just go to the Lord in prayer. As I'm praying here, make sure you're praying and connecting your heart to God. But right now, let's just pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you. Lord, we thank you and praise you that we can come into your presence. Lord, help us to always appreciate and never take for granted that we have the right to be called children of God. And the love that you bestowed on. Lord, help us to be aware of your love, to embrace your love, to be extensions of your love. So, Father, we pray that you strengthen your love within us. And as we embrace your love, and because you love us, because you first loved us, we have a love for you. Lord, help us to have this love for one another this morning. And so use us to encourage and strengthen one another. Use us to throughout this week to pray for one another and to text one another. You lay on our heart who needs prayer, who needs encouragement. Lord, use us to be examples of your love. We thank you. a work in us now. Change our will. Change our thoughts. Change our heart according to your will. Change our prayers. Father, strengthen our faith through these prayers this morning. Be with each one, each person in this building now as you draw us into your presence. Lord, we thank you that we can come here and worship you in spirit and truth. And Lord, we pray that your spirit is evident and it's your truth that we're pursuing. And Lord, right now we pray that, that you instill into us a desire to worship. And Lord, help us to put our distractions aside as we seek your kingdom and your righteousness. We thank you for the freedoms we have that we can come to you and worship you in this country, that we have these freedoms. No fear of persecution, and that we have this opportunity and privilege to worship you in this place. And Lord, continue to bless this country. Lord, we thank you that we can worship you in this way. We thank you for the freedom to vote. We thank you for all the freedoms we have. So we lift up our elected officials. We thank you for them. We ask that you convict them of their need for salvation. Convict them and make decisions according to your will and your word. Lord, we thank you for the support that our country has given Israel. We continue to pray for your nation. We pray for the peace of Jerusalem, the peace of Israel, the peace of your people right now as you protect. We pray that you be glorified through this ordeal. That you draw people and nations and individuals and religions to yourself and that you be glorified through this. And Lord, we just thank you. So right now, we commit this service to you. We commit this church to you. We commit our hearts to you. We commit our lives to you. It all belongs to you now. So do a work in us as you draw us into your presence, as you strengthen us, you give us a hunger and a thirst for your righteousness, you satisfy and fill. We pray that you be pleased with us. Allow us to bless the name of the Lord this morning as we worship our King, our Creator, in all the actions, efforts, and all that we do. Take joy from us now. We thank you for it. We thank you and praise you. We ask all these things in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. All right, you guys have 3 minutes. Make sure you let one another know if you're praying for them. Let one another know if you're happy to see them in the house of the Lord this morning. And you have 1:08.
Thank you. That's good. You know, I look back at my work history. You know, half is almost paid for.
Are you retired?
No. I'm working. I'm thinking out what should I do? You know, should I do? For, I don't need to do early retirement, which will be in December. Or 2.5 years, 65. That's the numbers go up.
My thoughts on that is between 62 and 65 would be a year. Someone has to get their answers. So rather than that, that was my thought on that.
Oh.
service, a man goes to the pastor in the back and says, "Pastor, I was hoping you could pray for my hearing." Pastor goes, absolutely. Grabs him by the head and goes, "Lord, give this man the ears that he needs. Give him strength to his ears. Give him the hearing. And in Jesus' name, be healed." And the man goes, "How's your hearing now?" He goes, "Well, I don't know. It's not until next Tuesday at the courthouse." Is that one of the ones that were like a lead balloon?
No,
that was a good one. Thanks. I got Kathleen's approval on that one. Thank you. Before there was even a church, healing was a part of our faith. Healing has been part of Christianity longer than there's been a Christianity. And we were even talking in Sunday school about signs and things of that sort. We're going to see that in Acts chapter 28, the passage we're going to look at this morning. As Paul is shipwrecked with his shipmates on an island of Malta, we see that he's going to perform some miraculous healings. We're not going to talk about the healing this morning. We're going to look at the healings. We're not going to talk about the science behind it. We're not going to talk about the gifts. We're not going to talk about the miracles. We're not going to talk about, well, what I want to talk about is the circumstances and the situation surrounding how Paul got there. What we call it, and we mentioned in Sunday school, what we call divine appointments. So we're going to look at the divine appointment that put Paul there so Paul can perform these miracles. We're going to look at the situation, the circumstances that put Paul there, not the healings itself. But we will mention the idea of the big signs and God using these signs, and we saw about that in Sunday school, but more than that, we're going to look at these divine appointments. And I'll mention it right now, because we start every Sunday service, every Sunday school, with kingdom moments. Kingdom moments, just to clarify, make sure we're all on the same page, is the idea of the Holy Spirit of God working through us. And so it's Jesus said, if I cast out demons by the Spirit of God, then the kingdom of God has come upon us. And Jesus also told us to pray, thy kingdom come, thy will be done. So when his will is done through us, it's his kingdom here on earth. One day we'll be in glory and we'll be doing God's will 100% of the time when we're in his kingdom 100% of the time. But until then, when we do his will, when he works through us and he functions through us, it's his kingdom come, his will be done. And I mentioned in Sunday school, we all heard this term, or some of us might not have, but the idea of divine appointments, where God orchestrates and God works a situation out to put us at a specific place at a specific time, and God divinely orchestrates an appointment for us. And I'm going to share the equation I shared in Sunday school, and then we'll pray. Divine appointment plus willing heart equals kingdom moment. So we're going to look at the divine appointments. We're going to look at the kingdom moments, but we're going to talk specifically about that willing heart. But before we do any of it, Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. Lord, thank you for the very words, very oracles of God that you have preserved and sustained for this moment right now, so that we can grow closer to you, so that we can learn from you, we can get a better understanding of ourselves and this world you place us in, and our faith and our needs. And Lord, we just thank you for the ways you work. We thank you for your Holy Spirit, Father. We thank you for your word. So speak to us through the very words of God that you have for us this morning. Speak to us through your Holy Spirit that what you have to say to us, not what I have to say, not my words, not my will, not my understanding, but Father, your will, your word, and your understanding. Speak to our hearts now. So as I ramble on externally, you are speaking to each one of our hearts, our souls, our spirits, and you're speaking to us internally. So Father, draw each one of us into your presence. Convict us of the things we need to know, but do a work in each one of us now as you speak through me. And we thank you for it. So put your words in my mouth as you speak to our hearts, and we thank you and praise you for this time. We ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, in Acts chapter 28, as we saw last week, that Paul was shipwrecked with Paul, Luke, Aristarchus, and 273 prisoners, soldiers, and crewmen, shipmen. They were shipwrecked on the island of Malta, and as they went, as they swam the shore, the cold, because it's November, they just got out of the Mediterranean, they're tired, because they were up all night, some of them probably for days, maybe weeks at a time. And Paul, the natives of Malta made them a fire, and Paul goes and collects wood for the fire. We saw that he got bit by a snake while he was collecting wood, but the people waited for him to swell up, fall over, and die, and when nothing happened, they saw, they said, moments and our willing hearts, I want to make sure everyone understands what I believe, what I understand real quick. I do not believe in coincidences. All right? I believe that God makes things happen, that God works specifically. He puts people in places, circumstances. He controls the weather. He controls the universe. He controls all the timing of everything. And he directs our hearts. He directs other people. He makes the shipwreck. And it just happened. They could have landed on any island. They could have got through got to Italy without a shipwreck. But God had their boat shipwrecked on the island of Malta. And it just so happened that they were on the land of a man named Publius. Publius was, it says, the leading man. This name Publius is also a Roman name, so we know that Publius was the Roman official on the island. Whether that was because he was the richest man on the island, you know, or he was the most influential man, or Rome might have sent someone to the island to be their governor or be their authority. We don't really know. We just know this man Publius had influence on the island because, maybe he had the influence first, we don't know, but he was the leading man because he was the Roman official. Whether it was governor or whether it was some other title, we don't specifically know. But he had this land, and just so happened they shipwrecked on his property. So I'm sure he saw the fire, and he welcomed. Now, again, it says, who welcomed us and entertained us courteously for 3 days. This courteously is another word for hospitality. He showed us hospitality, he showed us kindness, he was courteous to us. So I don't know who the we are or the us are. I don't know. I don't know if he just welcomed Paul, which is weird, because you think Julius would have went along with him, and you think the captain would have went along. Luke might have been along. Why didn't Aristarchus get to go? And I don't know if he entertained 276 men on his property. Probably did. Probably put up a barn. But this word courteous, here's what it is. You think of what these men would need. That's what Publius provided. Food? Probably. Water? Absolutely. Maybe dry clothes? Shelter? Covering, whatever it is, covers, something for the journey. He welcomed us and entertained us courteously. It means the idea that he provided whatever they needed. He made sure that they were taken care of for those 3 days that they were with him. By the way, they spent 3 months on the island. He only took care of them the first 3 days. Okay, he didn't entertain them for 3 months. But I love this picture because, like I said, I don't believe in coincidences. And I love the way Luke word this in verse 28. Go ahead, Jim. It says, and it happened, it just so happened. What a coincidence. It happened that Publius, the leading man, the guy who was shipwrecked on his property, it just so happened, what a coincidence, his father was sick. Anyone following the coincidence? Anyone believe that this is a coincidence? Anyone, or how many of you believe that God ordained and orchestrated this before the foundation of the world? That God knew this was going to happen. Look, by the way, in the 20th, the late 19th century, early 20th century, they discovered that the goat's milk, because of the grass, this is crazy. I did way too much research, and some of you like hearing what I shared stuff with. But because of the grass on Malta and the goats, the way they digest it, goat's milk created fevers and dysentery. It didn't discover until the 19th century. Okay? It's the late 19th or 20th century. So, but most people got dysentery and got, I'll be honest, first time I was in insurance and I would ask people about their diseases and their illnesses and things like this. And I would check off sometimes if they had dysentery, but check off if they ever had it. And it wasn't until Friday night that I actually Googled what dysentery is. I know some of you are laughing at me. It's disgusting. Alright? If you never have, don't ever Google dysentery. Don't even think about doing it. We'll just say it's explosive diarrhea and worse. Okay, we'll just leave it at that. Because some of you are wondering, because I know some of you might be wondering what it is, and I just wanted to make sure we're all on the same page here. But it was the goat's milk that did it. it's fascinating that this man Publius, his father, was lying in bed, afflicted with recurrent fever and dysentery, and Paul went to see him, and after he had prayed, he laid his hands on him, and the man was healed. Look, Paul being miraculously saved from a viper, and then now Paul laying his hands on this individual, which, by the way, this is one of the first times in the Bible we see someone laying hands on for healing. No, we won't get into that either. But we see this healing. This had to make an impact on the people there. I, like I said, I'm not going to go into the signs, I'm not going to go into it, but I today, 98% of Malta are practicing Catholics. Practicing. Now some people go, oh, well, the Catholic. Yeah, that's because they were early church, and then over the last 2,000 years, the church has changed, and now they followed Roman Catholicism. But what I think is fascinating is you have 98% of the island who are spiritually minded. 98%, and I said this in Sunday school, name any country, Israel or Vatican, every other, there's no other country that's 98, and the reason for this, I really believe, the reason that they're so spiritual is because they, the miracles they saw, and the things they passed down to their children, among the, they passed their children, who passed it on to their children, and the truths that they, because of these signs, because of these miracles, because of these healings. So it didn't just stop here as Paul left the island. We don't see any witnessing, we don't see any gospel presentation on Malta. But there's no doubt that these signs and the way that Paul talked and the way Paul prayed and the way Paul loved and the way they interacted with the people made an incredible impact. Here we are 2,000 years later and they're far more spiritual than our country, which was a Christian country 200 years ago. So anyway, so Paul heals them. Now, like I said, I don't believe in coincidence. In Ephesians, read that one, because in Ephesians chapter 1, we see that that also we obtained an inheritance, having been predestined according to his purpose, who works all things after the counsel of his will. So God works some things together to make it according to what he wants to do, right? God works most things, some things. Thank you. Thank you. I was making sure that some of you were awake. Okay. But God works all things after. Look, you know that he works all things together. According to his purpose. All things come together according to his will, of the counsel of his will. So God orchestrates it. So God places us in places. God gives us gifts and situations. God, if you're here, there's a reason that God woke you up. If you come into Albion Bible Church, there's a reason that God brought you to this church. If you live in New Jersey, I don't know why I do, but there's a reason God brought you to New Jersey. You know, there's a reason that God does these things. So you don't just go, oh, just my chance. Just, no, God's going to use you where he places you. And I'll go on for this in a minute, but these divine appointments, I believe, we need to have our eyes open to them. We need to be aware that God is constantly working because we see inconveniences. We see things that are annoyances. You know, whenever we have a delay or we get sidetracked or we get redirected or we have a change of plans, you know, we think of these things as intrusions. You know, we think of these things as inconveniences instead of looking and seeing how God is using these things to put us where he wants us. I don't even remember what year. Actually, I can tell you back in the year. It was 2015. In 2015, I rode my motorcycle to Minnesota with my brother out there. And it was a beautiful sunny day, gorgeous sunny day. I mean, it was perfect temperature, perfect weather to be on the bike. Ridge, it was gorgeous. It was like that you know, that temperature where you don't need a jacket, but it's not too cold, you know what I mean? It was that perfect temperature, perfect weather. And I'm cruising down on I think it was I-80 in Wisconsin or whatever, and out of nowhere, there wasn't even signs. It wasn't even, no warning, no thing. All of a sudden, a torrential downpour. Like normally the sky gets dark, or normally you hear thunder, or normally the clouds come out, nothing. Sunny weather, and all of a sudden, the sunny weather, it's a torrential downpour. And I'm like, soaked. And there's no overhangs for me to pull off. So I get off the next exit, and I just get off the exit, and I get off the turn in right away. As soon as I turn in, it's a gas station. So I pull in and go under the overhang of the gas station. And pull in. As soon as I do that, I look over, and there's a car in a weird parked spot about 50 feet from the gas station. And I'm like, the way it was sitting was weird. So get off the bike, run over in the rain. Do you need help with something? And she rolls down the window and goes, yes, please, I ran out of gas, I can't make it. So I said, all right. So I push her car up onto the gas station, and you know, she starts pumping her gas, and while she's pumping her gas, she tells me how her husband passed away not too long ago. She lost her house, and her daughter are moving now to go back to the town where her parents are from, and she's just giving this whole sob story. Her daughter's in the backseat crying, and they're just overwhelmed. I'm like, oh, look, I'm a pastor, I live in Philadelphia. Can I pray with you? And I pray with her. And the kind sent me a box of cookies, you know? And she kept sending me thank you notes like once a month, and would kept sending me, you know, just telling me updates about her life, and just, I saw the work and how God moved and changed in her life, and does not a doubt in my mind that torrential downpour was to get me off that exit. I don't know if it was raining anywhere else in Wisconsin. It might not have been. It might have been, you know, the cartoons, a cloud right over me, you know, and just the God get me off the exit. But there's not a doubt in my mind that God used where I was to accomplish what he wanted to get done. God used who I am to accomplish the things that he wants to accomplish. And so often we look at inconveniences, we look at intrusions, we look at annoyances. Well, let's go back to Acts, because next verse, he healed me. Paul healed this father. And after Paul healed the father, after this happened, the rest of the people in the island who had diseases, so all these sick and weird twisted people now from a weird island coming to you now. I'm not healing you next time. That's so that all the people from all the island came to him to get cured. Came to Paul to get cured. Alright? And now, what's funny with this is, I'll tell you another story. One time I was in Florida with a friend, and we were flying back up to Philadelphia, and they tell us that we can't fly into Philadelphia because of snow. All right, but my friend had to be back at a specific time, and he had to, so they did the delay. You have a flight tomorrow. We couldn't take that tomorrow flight. He just had to be back. That's good. So we found out we could fly into Harrisburg, which never made sense. We could fly into Harrisburg, but not Philadelphia. But we could fly into Harrisburg, and then we rented a car to drive from Harrisburg to Philadelphia. And we made it back in time, but now I dropped off his house, and now I have a rental car I have to return. So I made arrangements with another friend to pick up at the Philadelphia airport to drop off his rental car. And so I go drop off the rental car, and when I drop it off, this guy at the rental station was so annoying. Oh my goodness. Like, he wanted to make conversation with me. He wanted to talk to me, asking me about my day and my life. Then he started giving me advice on travels. Oh, next time you do that, you might want to do it. And he started giving me advice and started telling all these things. And it was just so annoying. It was wasting my time. I just wanted to drop this car, wait for my friend to come pick me up and get out of here. I was tired because I'd been up all night because I had to drive in. And I was frustrated. I was tired. I was looking at my circumstances, my situation. And then he said something that whenever someone says it to me, it triggers me. This is a kingdom moment opportunity. This is divine appointment. The man said, "So what do you do for a living?" I went, "Oh yeah, I'm not here to return a car." Oh yeah, I'm not. And so often we look at our life. I'm here for this. I'm a target to buy things. I'm at Walmart to get things. I can tell you another story about a Walmart thing, but I won't go into that. But so many times we think we're there for these things. But understand, if you are a child of God, then God is working. See, Ephesians chapter 2, one of my favorite verses. We know that we've been saved by faith. We all know that. Then it tells us in the very next verse, "For we are his workmanship." Think about that. If you look at the mountains, you look at the sunset, you look at the workmanship of the solar system, it's beautiful, it's amazing, it's powerful, it's miraculous, it's majestic. Any other act? But we are his workmanship. More than all that, he finds us more beautiful. More than all that, he finds us. But we are his workmanship, not only created in Christ Jesus to do good works that he prepared in advance for us to do so that we would walk in them. So he already knew that I was supposed to talk to that individual, which is so funny. I start talking to that rental car guy with a different mentality, a different idea. It turns out he was a friend of he was my friend's cousin's friend. And he had all these prayers that he was trying to get his kid back in church, and all these things. I talked and I met with him for breakfast two or three times after that, and I prayed with him and counseled with him and had Bible studies with him, and it was just because I looked at it differently. I didn't look at it as an inconvenience. I didn't look at it as annoyance. I realized that I am his workmanship, the workmanship of God created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which he prepared in advance for me to do. These were already sitting there waiting for me. I just had to have willing heart. He creates these opportunities. He creates these divine appointments. He creates, there's no such thing as coincidences. He puts us in places, and because we have certain gifts, he puts us in places because we're there, and we have a certain heart, a certain thought. He uses us. He puts us there. We're his workmanship, and he created us to do good works, which he prepared beforehand. So he creates the opportunities. We have to have the willing heart. So often, we get discouraged because of delays. We get discouraged because of changing plans. We get discouraged because, as I said, of intrusions or inconveniences or things that don't go according to the way I think they should go. But understand that God is in control. He put you there for a purpose. He gave you gifts for a reason. It's so interesting because we'll go back to Acts. This passage right here, they also, go back to the other passage, the other verse before. Okay. They also, I'm sorry. After this, they had the rest of the people couldn't die who had diseases, and they're coming to him to cure. Oh, that's what getting cured. It says cured in my Bible app on my phone. That word is getting healed. So I was looking for the word healed. But what's so fascinating? Now I'm going to share something with you that I read commentaries and they said this is not the case. Don't understand this, and I think he's wrong because I studied the Greek and I prayed over this. And I want to share something really cool with you guys. This word cured, and if you go back one verse, and this word healed, Paul healed him, two different words. One, this word healed has to do with spiritual and had the connotation of miracle. Go back to the other one. This word cured has to do with a doctor and physician appearing, and a physician healing physically. See, they came to Paul. But Luke was also contributing. I love this picture. I love the picture. Because, ladies and gentlemen, this right here is the first medical missionaries. Yeah. It's the first medical missionaries. All the people that were coming to them, and Paul was doing miracles, and Luke was being a doctor. And some of them were not, some of the infirmities and some of the diseases, some of the illnesses were not ones that needed a miraculous healing. The reason I'm bringing this up is because I am a good preacher and teacher. But you know what I'm also good at? I'm a great athlete. Very athletic. Alright? I am. Let me prove it. Jump real high. Jump real fast. But I have spiritual gifts. But I also have God-given abilities. And so often, we have opportunities to use our God-given abilities to bring glory to Him. So we all have God-given abilities. And so let's understand that, yes, I'm going to call Kevin out real quick. Kevin, I hope you don't. I don't know, but some of you know Kevin, what I think of one of Kevin's ministries, is Kevin goes to homes. When someone passed away, he works with a funeral home, and he goes and helps collect the body. Well, I think that's an incredible thing because Kevin's using his God-given abilities. There's no spiritual gift involved in that. But the idea that God, well, some people go out and something, but the idea that God had given Kevin abilities, and Kevin was placed in a certain situation, and God uses where we are to accomplish things we never knew we could. God uses who we are to help people in ways we never knew we were able to. God uses who we are and what we can do to accomplish things we never thought we could do. As if Kevin has ability, picking up a body, being around a dead body, not a big deal. But God uses that ability God uses Kevin in ways that we never thought we could be used. So we need to understand that God places us. He's given us gifts. He's given us abilities. Not just spiritual gifts. He's given us abilities. And we're supposed to use those to make an impact. We're supposed to use those to bring glory to Himself. We're supposed to use those to advance His kingdom. We're supposed to use those as what we call kingdom moments. Now, I have a couple minutes left. I want to use this one last part here. It says, they also honored us with many marks of respect. And when we were setting sail, they supplied us with all we needed. This is such a cool thing. Open Romans 15, 26 and 27. Romans chapter 15, we see also in 1 Corinthians chapter 9. We see in chapter 8. We see a number of times, from Macedonia and Achaia have been pleased to make contributions for the poor among the saints in Jerusalem. So you had all these Gentile churches giving to the Jews who were in Jerusalem who were poor. And Paul says, yes, they were pleased to do so, and they are indebted to them. So the Gentiles are indebted to the Jews. Why? For if the Gentiles have shared in their spiritual things, they are indebted to minister to them also in material things. I love Wawa. You guys know why I love Wawa? been shucking the Wawas. For some reason, the law of reciprocity rests in Wawa. Alright? And I love that. People want to reciprocate. Well, reciprocity is not just a Wawa principle. It's a Christian principle. When someone does for us, we should have this heart to want to give back to them. And that's what the people are doing here. But I want to share real quick. I want to help us to understand this. Because imagine if Paul, because this is fellowship. The people receive from Paul. And so what they wanted to do is they wanted to give back to Paul. You see how that works? They received from Paul. So as a ministry, they wanted to give back to Paul. They gave Paul more things than he needed. They didn't. They supplied all the needs, and they even went above and beyond, and they with incredible honor. And if you look at that, if you go back to Acts, it says they honored us. Go back. And so they also honored us with many marks of respect. It was above and beyond what they needed. They gave them more than they needed. Now imagine if Paul said, "I don't need this. Take it back." How would the people of Malta feel? All right, I'm saying that because if you ever receive a gift from somebody and God laid it on their heart to give it to you, take it. Don't let your pride, don't let your feelings interfere. And if God leaves it on your heart to give a gift, give it. Don't let your finances, don't let your worries, don't let your fears interfere. See, these are also kingdom moments. These are also opportunities for God to use us to encourage one another. God use us to lift one another. God use us. So it doesn't have to be material. It doesn't have to be finance. It doesn't have to be money. But there's opportunities for us to lift one another, encourage one another, serve one another, build one another up. And far too often, we go, well, I don't need that. Oh, I don't need a ride. No, it's let the other person minister to you, because that's the beauty of fellowship. Far too often, we reject money, or reject food, or we reject service. We reject other people's ministry when God is laying on them to serve us. Well, that's part of the process, part of the principle and the beauty of the church is this reciprocity, this fellowship of give and receive. And so far too often, we let our own decisions get in the way of His kingdom come. His will, but far too often, it's our feelings get in the way of God's will being done. Can you pull 1 Peter chapter 3 for me? And I'll enter this. Chapter 3, verse 15. Everyone knows this verse. We've all heard this verse before. I actually quote this verse to John the other day. I quote this verse to someone. But 1 Peter 15 says, sanctify Christ as Lord in your heart. Always be ready to make a defense for to anyone who asks to give you account for the hope that is in you, yet with gentleness and reverence. And we use this as a verse for evangelism. Always have an answer. Always have your testimony. Always have an answer ready for someone asking to hope. But you know how we make sure that we have an answer? You know how we make sure we're ready? You know how we make sure? It says, sanctify Christ as Lord in your hearts. Yeah. That's what it comes down to. It's setting Christ aside in our hearts for the purpose of holiness, he, for the purpose of service, for the minute, that Christ reigns in our hearts, that's the focus, that he's not just sitting there with everything else, like, I like the Eagles, I like the Phillies, and I like Jesus. No, it's not about that. It's Christ is sanctified, he's set apart, he's different, he's holy, and so it can't be about our feelings, it can't be about our pains, it can't be about our pride, it can't be about our insecurities, it can't be about these things, because we need to sanctify Christ in our heart and let him work. See, the challenge that we don't have able to minister, and we're not able to serve, we're not able to do these things, is because we let our own decisions, our own feelings get in the way. Instead of sanctifying Christ in our heart and always being ready, we go, well, maybe this situation is different, this circumstance is different. Well, not this situation, not this circumstance. And we have our own feelings and decisions. So we're about to sing, I have decided to follow Jesus. And I want us all to sing that honestly to God. And I think we need to understand. I'll tell you a little quick story. Ronald Reagan went to a cobbler when he was like 10 years old. Cobbler as in the guy who makes shoes, not in the peach. Okay? But the guy who makes shoes, he went to this cobbler, and the guy asked him, do you want a round toe or a flat toe? And Reagan goes, I don't know. The guy goes, all right, well, we'll see. And then a couple days later, he saw him in the streets, and the cobbler says, so, Ron, did you figure out whether you want a round toe or a square toe? He goes, I don't know. So he goes, all right, well, your shoes will be ready tomorrow. Come pick them up. He showed up the next day. He had one rounded toe and one square toe. And Ronald Reagan at 9, 10 years old had to go to school with one round toe and one square toe. And he said that instilled into him for the rest of his life, he remembered that if I don't make a decision is still being made. And what's homicide? What is homicide? To kill someone else. What's suicide? What's pesticide? To kill bugs. How about genocide? What's decide? To kill off all other options. See, far too often, we keep the option there of not listening to Jesus. Far too often, it's the option of my will, not his. And that's not following Jesus. See, when we make the decision, I have decided to follow him. There's no other options. The only option, that's what decide is, to kill off all other options. And we make a decision that I'm not going to do it my way. I'm not going to do my will. I have decided to follow him. Let his will be done. His kingdom come. His will be done. So when we see these divine appointments and we have that willing heart, well, we can see his kingdom come. And it starts. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are at work in our lives. Lord, we thank you that you've called us to your name. We thank you that you have orchestrated the weather and the solar system and all that, all everything this world has, you are sovereign and over it. And Lord, we thank you that you continue to do a work in our lives. So open up doors for us to speak. Give us the courage to follow after. Lord, truly help us to make that decision to follow. That even though we have fears and worries and anxieties, our doubts, our insecurities, Lord, we pray that you continue to strengthen us, that you continue to do a work in us, and you continue to convict us of the decision to follow you. Lord, we thank you that you are sovereign, and we thank you for these kingdom moments. We thank you for these divine appointments. Lord, give us willing hearts to follow you. So we thank you. We thank you for this body. Continue to be blessed by us as we lead, as you are pleased with all that we do. Jesus
wiper hanging.